Cavern or Concept Show. I'm your host, Paul Rook, and as always, we are joined in the studio by Kerry and Richard. Hello, guys.
Hello.
Hello. How is apart from what we're going to be speaking about tonight, what have you been up to?
Well, I finished a blog. Yes, I finished the blog. I know. Up on the website, paranormalconcept.com, everybody.
And you know what? I've actually read it. And I sent back another one to be proofread for you.
Yeah, oh, I know. Nice. I haven't had a chance to read it yet. What did you think of mine?
Been doing nothing all day, have you?
Yeah, all right. I'll sit around swinging on my chair all day, Richard. Richard, can you believe this?
Well, there you go, and that's him, isn't it? all over. It reminds me of doing blogs, because I'm supposed to be writing a blog about, well, the weekend we've just had, but I thought I'd wait until we do the show, then hopefully I can get a few more inroads.
Well, hold on one second. I still haven't heard what you both thought of my blog.
Wonderful blog. Absolutely wonderful.
I haven't read it yet.
Really? Really? This is what I get to work with, people out there listening. This is what I get to work with.
Oh, come on, right? I read the title when I thought to myself, Noah's Birds. Does that mean he's got one for every day of the week?
Yeah, Noah's Birds, yeah. It sort of, it makes Noah out to be some sort of, I don't know, stud or something. Yeah.
If you'd read it, Richard, you'd know it wasn't about that. Mm-hmm. Anyway, let's move on swiftly, shall we?
Yeah, we should, actually. Okay, so we're joined in the studio. Let's just do a bit of background first. We went on an investigation to RAF Nettishead at the weekend, and we invited with us West Yorkshire Paranormal. Although Kerry seems to think that Lincolnshire Paranormal. So yeah, we want to introduce Jason.
We know them really well.
Jason, Anna and Lucy from West Yorkshire Paranormal. Hello.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
And it is Jason, not Justin.
Yeah, Kerry calls you Justin all the time, so
I know.
Yeah, but Jay calls Richard Neil.
Yeah, I know, right?
Yes.
It's going to be a fun show, isn't it?
Like a Neil. And the really funny thing about this out there, guys listening, is we actually know them really well. You know, one of those things.
Well, one question I've got for Jason before we start. Did you actually manage to get out of the car without a can opener?
I'll tell you something, like my leg the next day, I thought I'd pull my hamstring or something. I couldn't even hardly walk. It was like traveling for 5 hours in a submarine on the floor.
Oh dear.
Well, I'm glad you got out of that, okay.
It's all right, we've got you a little toolbox, Jason, with some WD-40 and a couple of can openers for the next one, though.
Oh, bless him. He likes his car, but I don't know how he copes with that.
Okay. Ready for the first question then, Kerry?
Oh, okay, so I'm taking over now, am I? Okay, so we went to RAF Nettishead. What did, first of all, in the second half of the show, we'll go into a more broader paranormal spectrum, but I want to focus on the actual event we did first. So what was your first impressions, guys, of RAF Nettishead?
Well, I thought it was very sort of like, nice sort of well-maintained sort of building. It was sort of, you know, not quite what I expected, but actually going in, it was very well managed and a well-kept building, and the artifacts they had there, sort of like they had a lot of equipment, considering that RAF and Nettishead, it's not an actual airfield like people think. It never had planes actually stationed there, and it's an actual radar station, and it's what the RAF used since World War II up until relatively recently. And I was very impressed with the place, sort of on an aesthetic level.
Jason?
I thought it was a lot bigger than what you look on the outside. It doesn't look that big, but when you get inside, I mean, we spent a good half an hour all walking around completely lost. It's very, yeah, like
it was a bit of a maze, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's a maze, but it is very clean. It's well set out. They're all volunteers, and for a volunteer run museum, it's really well maintained. It's really good. I didn't get enough time to actually look around the whole place. Mm-hmm. It was there quite a while, but still, I didn't feel like I did the place justice enough to walk around and look at everything.
I know what you meant by it being a maze. I actually set up my experiment in a room, and I never actually found it until the end of the night. I had to go wandering from room to room, but I managed to get it in the end.
Yeah, it's good. It's really good. It's one of my favorite. You know, I like going. We've been to like Sunderland before, but for the war museum and stuff, it's one of my favorites because it was so much things in there and just not enough time to look around the whole thing.
Paul, you're the one who booked it. You booked it as a team share for people. What was the appeal for you before you even went there to book
it? It was a location that I've never been to before. And I wanted to find a location that I've not done before. And Netishead just jumped out. I mean, not only that,
he's not very well done on circuit either.
No, and Lucy was one of the other people that said, yeah, let's do it. So I looked into it. The price was quite reasonable. So I thought, yeah, okay, we could do this. I knew full well that I wouldn't set it as a public investigation because I don't want to do public events anymore. I'd rather just stick to paranormal teams because then we can share. And then we all know what we're doing. I'm not hand-holding all the way through the night anymore.
Not babysitting.
So I can get to do some investigating and research as well. Lucy's friends with Jason, and we asked if they wanted to join us on this team share. And we just split it 50-50. And, yeah, it went well, and I thought. I loved the investigation. The location wasn't as I thought it had been, because I just imagined something a bit like Kelvin Patch. But nevertheless, it was still a really interesting location. And I think there's a lot of residual stuff going on as opposed to active spiritual activity. But it was still an interesting place. I mean, we picked up quite a few little bits and pieces. We heard noises and stuff, and yeah, it was just a really interesting night.
It was a good night. Now, Anna, in amongst all of this, we had COVID, didn't we, to consider when we was investigating.
Weird.
And it was very strange, wasn't it, to do a team share, which was okay because you could keep in your bubble of team, as it were. How do you feel that impacted the investigation that went ahead? Do you think it impacted or not?
Well, I think there's a few things, really. First of all, nobody had really been out for ages, so we're all sort of getting back into the groove of doing it. You know, we're probably not. Well, I think last time we were out was September last year, and that was, we were out once, I think, and then before that it was February. So we were sort of getting back into the groove. But I think it's sort of doing it with masks and sort of having that little air of caution that everybody's got at the moment, which you do naturally, don't you? We're all conditioned now to sort of do the social distancing. So, I mean, for me, it felt quite comfortable and safe. We were all in our little groups. We all had our masks on. So yeah, it had a little bit of an impact, but it didn't impact on the enjoyment, I should say.
No, it certainly didn't. And the way the place is laid out is actually quite good, isn't it? Because you could actually section it off and then swap at various times. And the only thing I would have said was you had to set time. So you had every team had their go, I suppose, in each section. Mm-hmm. And that's not always fantastic. I'm not going to lie about that. That's not ideal. And under normal circumstances, it wouldn't have mattered. But because of the COVID restrictions, which we were very strict about, so all kudos to Paul and Lucy for organising that side of things, because that couldn't have been easy. That's the only thing I would say negatively about the evening on that one. Everyone kept their bubbles. Everyone kept separate. Everyone adhered to the time that they had in each section. Thought that was really good.
It was, and I think the runway system added to the confusion about where things were, which obviously it's there for everybody's safety, but in terms of how the museum was laid out, because we were then going on that one route,
yes.
it did mean we were sort of like, oh, if we'd gone past this bit.
Yeah, a little bit, but it's challenging it times is. For everybody, I think. And
but we adapted.
Yeah, we all did adapt. Mm. There was another team there, it was the Paranormal Charity Warriors, who we not got on tonight, but they were there, so hi to the girls, because they were great fun. Yeah. Nice to meet those girls too. But it was very challenging, which anything that you organise these days is challenging, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I would certainly go along with that. I mean, you know, and we are living in different times. I mean, it's going to be a long time before things get back to any sort of normal or what they were before. I mean, I feel the weekend and the way it went, I can live with that.
Mm.
That's nothing too difficult to ask.
So, Lucy, in that part of that organisation side of things, what were your considerations? How did you, because you only had a map of the place before you went, didn't you?
Yeah, we didn't actually get to, we just booked it as a one-off. We didn't book it without going and seeking out the location before. We only had got to see the location on the Saturday morning, so only a few hours before you guys arrived. So, like you said, we just divided it up into four teams because we knew we had four teams going. And just try to please everybody, really, and just make sure we've got all the procedures in place that they need as well. And that is the hardest thing, getting that set in stone before dealing with you guys, dealing with the legalities that come with it, because it's changing every day, pretty much.
It is at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah. It's crazy. I think I've gone grey, let's put it that way.
Well, having said that, I will give you a huge amount of praise on that, because it went flawlessly and I felt very safe doing that location. And the location itself was kept incredibly clean. It was spotless, wasn't it, guys?
Oh, yeah.
It was. And the staff that were there were really friendly, yeah, as well. Really, really nice.
Yeah, big shout out to Jeremy and all the guys down at Nettisette for doing a fantastic job. Like Jason said before, they are all volunteers. They don't get paid for it. So massive, massive thanks to them for looking after us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we've got all that kind of side to it sorted and addressed, let's talk investigation. Did we get anything for a start? Let's just go hit in. Did we get anything? What do we think?
Little bits. Not massive bits, but little bits. Like Paul says, probably a lot of it's probably residual. But I did think one certain section of that museum had something in there, because a lot of people were drawn to it. And that's where you were, Curry, at the start as well, which was the Jaguar and Tornado cockpit area.
Yeah.
Which I thought, for me, that was a hot spot in there. That area down there was where most people were getting the stuff. And in the World War II room, was it next door to it?
The map room.
Yeah, the map room. Yeah.
Yeah.
Didn't really get anything anywhere else. A little bit in the, I can't remember what it's called, the radar part where all the machines were. Do you know, like the hub?
The control room.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, that had some little bits in there, but the rest of the place I didn't really get much. Went outside and I spent a lot of time walking around exploring the place, because it's huge. you kind of stop investigating when you get outside, so I didn't really investigate much outside. But yeah, I thought they were two of the hot spots for me.
Anna, where was the hot spots for you, love?
Well, I mean, I was saying this to Jason earlier. I was sort of drawn to where that Jaguar, those planes were, but I put it down to the fact it was down a dark corridor, and I'm always drawn down to dark corridors. so I don't know. But yeah, I mean, on the whole, it's pretty quiet for me. But I'm not sensitive in any way. So unless, you know, something's happening and I can hear something or there's equipment going off, I'm not really picking up on anything else. I had a little investigate on my own in the little room opposite the cafe area where we had the base room.
Yeah.
I had a bit of cat ball action going on there, but nothing really. I was testing another bit of equipment, and so I was like saying, oh, can you go and test this bit of equipment for me? But it didn't test the bit that I wanted to, and just the cat ball flash. So I have no idea with that. I'm not saying it's paranormal. It could be a misfired cat ball.
A misfired cat ball. Lovely. Lucy, where was the hot spots for you?
It's in the cockpit area that I got stuff like psychically mainly, but it was in the, oh, I can't think what the name of it was. You go past the control room and you go up and it's like where the ejector seat was, in that kind of area.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I know we all went up there in our little group to start with, and then I went up with Jason's team, and I both smelt what was smelling in that room. So it was more like smelling phenomena in there, of tobacco and aftershave. And it was nobody's aftershave that was in there of the guys, because I went around smelling everybody.
Yeah, there was a lot of sniffing going on at that point in time, I would say that. Because the smell of tobacco was incredibly strong. And it was, now I smoke tobacco. I hold my hands up, I am a smoker. And I could smell it, and I don't normally smell cigarettes or tobacco smells because I smoke, but I smelt it very, very strongly, and it wasn't a normal kind of what you get now kind of smell. It was a very distinct...
It was like pipe smoke, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Really exactly. Pipe smoke. Sort of, and when I smelt it, I sort of like it reminded me of my primary school headmaster used to smoke a pipe, and his office, not that I was called into it much, was smelt like that, just like that. Yeah.
And we were smelling this aftershave. And again, as Lucy said, we kind of were going around smelling everybody. And one of the things you should do when you go on investigation is actually not wear perfume or aftershave, just your normal deodorant. That's it. That's all you should wear because of that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think so, yeah.
That is one of the main things that they say to rule out that kind of phenomena. But we could smell it. So we were sniffing everybody to see if we was anybody in the team that had it on. And the only person that was quite, I don't mean this disrespectfully, it was a lovely smell, was Mark Manley. He had a quite a strong aftershave on, but it wasn't that smell, was it?
No, it was like something my granddad wear, like, you know, like a Brut or an Old Spice or kind of like that era kind of smell, like aftershave.
Mm-hmm.
It was that kind of smell. It was really strong and really distinctive. But I smelled it again when I went in again with one of Jason's team, Amy, and she could smell it. It was really weird because I'm going around smelling everything on the walls to see.
I can't smell it now.
Coming from that, like an internal source, like an air freshener of some sort.
But there wasn't anything like that, was
no,
there?
And you couldn't see anything. It was insane.
It was, Paul, what kind of things were you drawn to? You know, which areas were you drawn to?
I quite liked the control room. That had a weird essence in the air. but that was pretty much it, really, for me. I was the only one out of all three of us to actually do a live vigil and done it on live as well in the cockpit room.
Right.
As you said, was the hot spot. Although I didn't really get much in there. There was like, I think there was like a few footsteps where that could have been Richard looking for his room. and
probably.
There was like tapping noises coming from the back, but I think that could be more to do with the lights cooling down.
Yeah, you heard that before you did that though, didn't you?
Yeah.
Was it me and Amy was in there?
Yeah, that's right. But other than that, it was pretty much flat in there for me. But the live is still on the Paranormal Concept page, so you can have a look at that. Maybe someone else picked up on something that I couldn't see or feel.
Richard, where was you drawn to in the location?
I suppose I was doing some dowsing and I didn't... And the dowsing I was doing, I first walked the whole location with the pendulum. And I only got a couple of areas. One was in the main hallway, just outside the actual hub room. And I got one in the, and I got a very good response in the control room. But down the bottom of the control room, there's a little alcove that led out of it. And I got a response in there, along with a smell of tobacco. So those were the only two areas. Plus, when we sat down a bit later in the evening, we done a yes-no, yes-no session with me on the dowsing rods when you guys were asking questions. Those were about the only three places I could pick anything up.
Okay. So that's kind of pretty much where I was getting hits myself.
Yeah.
The three areas, really. Mm. So let's have a look at this more deeply. So in the let's focus on the cockpit area.
Yeah.
We all investigated that individually.
Yeah.
Different teams. Obviously, me with the guys and the West Yorkshire team did it separately. Now, I first walked in there. It was a very heavy energy. So I actually set a crystal grid up to try and lighten the energy and make that communication flow easier. But I have to say, when I went back at later part of the evening, the atmosphere was lighter, but I didn't feel the connection was stronger. And I don't think we actually got anything major in that particular area. We had the Paratech going, we had a couple of apps going at the time, and the words coming through, I don't like those bits of tech, to be fair, because I think they're very subjective. But interesting in its own way, because Mark was, loves his apps, doesn't he?
Yeah.
But there was nothing definitive that I would say, yeah. What did you guys get when you were in there, Anna and Jason?
Well, I didn't really investigate in there, but I went in there with Amy and I just asked her, because we were sort of doing a bit of an experiment, because she's sort of trying to see what kind of things she picks up. So I just went in there and asked her what she was picking up. And then I asked John, who's also on the team, what he was picking up independently, so they couldn't corroborate the stories. Both of them were drawn to left, I think it was the left-hand plane, the one nearest the wall, as opposed to the one nearest the war room.
Yeah.
And both were picking up on something walking along at the back. Both of them said the same thing, but that's pretty much all I did in there, was just question what other people were picking up.
Okay.
I wanted to go back, but it was quite a busy spot. Everybody wanted to be in there.
Yeah. Yeah, it was one of those areas, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Jason?
Well, for me, it definitely started on walk around, because I felt the heaviness that you were talking about. And I don't normally get headaches at all on a location, but after I've been in there, I went and got some paracetamol after that. As you were setting up your crystal grid thing, there was some knocking sounds towards one of the playing areas in the corner. Which I think Lucy picked up one of them at the time. And when I walked back in there later on, I think Chris was in there and he had some balls on the floor and one of the balls moved, so that was quite interesting.
That was one of the balls you've got to really shake it to make it light, isn't it? Because he was showing me that.
Yeah, it was one of the cheaper balls that you get from Power and Shop, but yeah, it was going off and actually moved as well. So that was good, you know, I thought that was quite interesting. Didn't happen again. And again, they got some words on the machines. They got, I wrote it down, they got Weston and Scallon, which could be anything. It could be a surname. It could be all. I've not had a chance to check on it. So
they also got the insect, didn't they? And then apparently it was like a centipede crawling on the floor.
Yeah, that was a strange thing. Yeah. Yeah. They had an app and it said insect. And then and when they took a picture of it, underneath it was a millipede walking underneath it. So make of you want with that. Very, very strange.
Yeah. Make of that what you will.
Yeah. Never had that before, so I was like, well, I don't know. But then I actually found, because I left them to it and I went into the map room, which is just beyond that room. It's kind of on a diagonal to it. And as I walked in, the two ladies who were staff members were behind me and they heard three whistles as I walked in. There was then like a really cold draft ahead of us and it went in a bit further in the room. Then it was followed by three knocks, but then it just completely stopped. So that was quite interesting as well. So that for me, that was the areas that I was trying to concentrate more on. And again, we had a little cat ball moving there, but I don't know. I don't, I'm not too sure about cat balls. Sorry, Anna.
No, it's all right. Well, that's why I said I didn't know if I was having a misfiring cat ball, because that's why I've numbered all mine.
Right. Now, the flooring in this place, it's like a demountable, aren't they?
Yeah.
So...
There were some areas that were sort of wooden flooring, but some of the bigger areas were actually concrete, sort of directly onto concrete. So I should imagine the central part of the building was a concrete base, and as they added onto it, they probably added on demountables. So you could hear a lot that was going on.
Some of it was the original building.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the map room was apparently a workshop. Because when the staff members were in there, they were asking questions a bit, and I said, "What?" They were asking, "Oh, are you working here?" And I said, "What work used to be here?" And so they said, "Oh, this used to be the workshop area." So I asked them to ask some things based on the workshop, but nothing happened. But it was good to have them there, because they could then say, "It's not what it is now; it's what it was before." So that was good having them there.
That is the only trouble, isn't it, when you go to places like that? It's seeing beyond what's there now and trying to link into what it was originally, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Because it's very easy to get caught up with the artifacts that are around you and the way it's set up now.
Oh, it can be very sort of misleading sort of suggestion-wise, because I think we all thought at some point there were aircraft actually based there. It wasn't like an airfield, but it never was. It was always intended as what it is now, a radar station or a radar plotting station.
But there are aircraft nearby.
Yes, there are. Well, that part of Norfolk, yeah, have got a few air bases nearby.
Quite nearby, as in across the road nearby.
No, it's not. It's about half an hour in the car, because we went past it on the way past. On the way home, we went past, they've got radars up there and obviously massive big hangars. So,
obviously I thought we could see the radar, what do they call it?
Oh, that building, that is, that part of Nettishead is still used by the military, and that is the only part that's actually used. And that is just that building and its surveillance equipment that's in there.
What, across where we was looking out from the back of the base, you could see that tall tower thing.
Yeah.
It's known as the officer's mess, that building directly in front. I think you did tell us what they do.
Yeah, they still use it.
They still use it, but it's nothing to do with.
But the planes aren't that close?
No, there's no aircraft that close, no.
Okay. Anybody else got anything to say to that?
You seem disappointed, Kerry.
No. I was under the impression it was like literally over the road.
No.
Because I'm sure that man told me, he said, yeah, it's just over there.
Yeah, I sort of spoke to him, and he goes, the only part that's actually still used and is called RAF and Nettishead was over the back where that building was next to the big tower. That is still a radar installation there.
But that's where the planes are.
I would have thought they'd have some planes there, but I don't. I don't think so.
Didn't it say in the guidebook that they had some kind of confirmed kill or something?
I can't remember, I know.
I'm not sure. That's saying we can.
We've got a guidebook here.
Yeah, I've got it here. It says that Judith's first kill when a Czech warrant officer pilot of 68 Squadron shot down an enemy aircraft while being controlled by them. So,
would it have just scrambled it though? Because it could have scrambled it from a nearby base. Because I remember all those buttons on the air in the control room. It had things like scramble and whatnot.
No, lots of buttons to press. Wasn't I pressing buttons as well?
Yeah, I was. I was intrigued by the one that said pigeon.
Pigeon?
Yeah, it said pigeon. I took a photograph because I was kind of thinking, what does that mean? Yeah. I can't think there's like controlled pigeons flying around.
Yeah, release the
pigeon. Release the pigeon. That reminds me of a cartoon back in the day. Oh, God, that's gone down a whole different thought pattern in my head. Anyway, okay. So this is a radar centre, nothing to do with planes, but there were planes nearby, so... It's kind of difficult, isn't it? Because you've got to see beyond what it was. and the setup that it is now, but that doesn't mean external influences wouldn't have been necessarily picked up whilst you were in the location, right?
Well, no,
yeah, yeah. No, that's right, because there are artifacts from planes and stuff that are in there, so you know you could pick up energies from those.
So, question then, guys. Do we think we were actually getting anything in regards to the location itself or linked to the artifacts?
That's hard to say.
Because there was nothing hugely definitive, was there?
No.
No, I think there was a couple of times a fire mentioned, wasn't there?
Yeah.
The part of the building we was in was destroyed by a fire at one point. So I would say that that is more obviously to do with the Nessie's Bed base. But some of the other things that were going on possibly could have been from some of the artifacts that were brought in.
Yeah. My sort of overall sort of like impression of the base, I don't think there's anything there permanently, if you know what I mean. I mean, from what we were picking up, it was very sort of we were just sort of tuning into the general ether, you know, perhaps the general surround. I mean, if you would ask me to say, right, you've got the place to yourself, and would you sleep there and overnight and by yourself, and I'd have no problem. Kelvedon Hatch, I would say no, but that place I'd have no problem.
I agree with that, actually. Yeah, it was a very comfortable building, wasn't it?
Yes, that's well put. Yeah, you felt at ease there.
The only bit I felt uncomfortable was when we came out of the calf bit, and then there was those steps that led up. That was the only uneasiness I had there.
What, to the upper offices are you talking about, the wooden staircase?
Yeah, the ones that you went up, the ones that we didn't think about going up into, even though we had the whole building.
Well, that was turned over, to be fair.
Yeah, that's the only time I felt uneasy there, and that was maybe because we didn't go up the next floor. But I said that at the beginning when we did the walk around in the day, didn't I?
Yeah.
So that was the only time I felt uneasy. But apart from that, everywhere was perfectly fine.
Okay, so, well, it's a difficult one for me because I can look at it very sceptically, this location, mm-hmm. but I also found it very interesting on a different level as well.
Mm. Yeah.
So looking at it from a purely what did we get kind of night, it was very interesting watching and listening actually to the different teams talking about things that they'd got and things that they'd experienced. Everybody said they felt rusty,
mm-hmm. yeah.
which is very understandable under the circumstances. And when we first entered the location, we was all in such high spirit. Well, God, we're out investigating, guys. Do you know what I mean? It was very high spirit. And then that sort of like carried us through the evening. Do you not think that was an influence?
Yeah, yeah. I just think also the teams, you know, we all gelled really well together. I mean, it's like we've all worked together before. We were just off and we had no problems. I mean, it was good to see other people's skills as well, you know, like, because I've not really seen anyone do crystals like you before. So that was good for me to see.
Yeah, I found that absolutely brilliant to watch.
We had mediums, we had skeptics, we had normal people just go collecting the evidence, and it just all gelled together to get the story, and it just worked really well.
Yeah, it's like when our group and the Charity of Warriors, we went into a side room at the end of the evening to do like a full seance. I mean, that was difficult. That was hard work, I found.
Yeah, it was hard.
You know, sort of, that's the first time I've been involved in a seance when, you know, it's been pretty dead, which... Yeah, and whether that can be sort of used as a sort of indicator that there's sort of say nothing that net is head. I don't know.
I wouldn't go that far. I think the seance that we did in the side room was misplaced. Does that make sense?
Yeah, you're probably right.
That's what I felt about that one. I felt that was more an exercise in individual focus rather than the location focus. That's how I felt about that. In my personal perspective. And I found that for me worked brilliantly. I was seeing stuff in the ball and that, but nothing linked to the location. That was all linked to self.
Right. I see.
And a couple of the other girls said that they got Lilith through, but that had been suggested. Mm-hmm. And then I went down my thought patterns of psychological suggestion as to being an influence on maybe what they got.
Right, I see, yeah.
Out of that seance. But I didn't think it wasn't a good experiment. I thought it was a very good experiment. I love a seance. But it was individual focus rather than location focus. So in my personal opinion, it was interesting.
Yeah.
But misplaced.
Yeah, I mean, seances are tricky things, isn't it? You know, it's sort of like the amount of people they can, and they can be a bit overcrowded at times, can't they? You know, it's very sort of, you know, you have to balance them just right.
So did we do any EVP sessions? I did, and I didn't get anything. Did you guys get anything EVP-wise?
So, well, I've listened to so far, I haven't got anything. I've not listened to everything. So still hope, and I've still got to check in with the rest of the team and see if they've got anything. But probably it's not looking good.
Well, I've taken recordings, but I haven't had a chance to listen back to any of them so far. So, you know, hopefully, you never know. But, yeah, still to do.
Right. I want to go on to the Ouija board session that we did in the control centre. Mm-hmm. And I want to bring Paul in on this one.
Right. He always ruins our Ouija board sessions.
I'm going to come in on this subject.
Paul. Right, we set up a Ouija board session. I got a grid going. There was a Ouija board session going on. We was in the control room. And when the girls were on it, nothing. Dead as a goddamn doornail. Nothing at all. So it's like, right, okay, let's get the men on now. So the men stepped forward and got onto the board, Paul being one of those men. It went bonkers. Right, first of all, there was three men on that board. Do you trust all those members that were on the board?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they were not pushing the planchette.
Well, I was one of them, yeah.
No, not one.
I'm asking the question because that's the kind of questions that get asked, guys.
Yeah, no, I trust everyone that was on that board.
And I actually rigged my planchette as well. So if anyone does push it, it flips up.
It does. I can verify that. You literally have to have your fingertip, like fingernail balanced on it.
Yeah.
The minute you try and push that planchette, it does tip. Because, you know, like when you readjust your... You know, like when you're doing it, you sometimes readjust your body posture. Even that can tip it.
Yeah.
Just doing that. So I could verify that, having been on the board. Paul, what was you getting on the board?
I do believe the first thing it spelled out, because it said yes, that there was someone there. So we asked for a name, and I do believe it came up with Zozo. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yes.
And that indicates to me that there's a energy either attached to me or the board. Because every time I use the board, that's what comes through. And it's a spirit that we call George.
Yeah.
And that really sort of started when I went to the Haunted Antiques Paranormal Research Centre for the first time. And this spirit kept asking me to go back through my other teams. You know, it asked for my name and stuff like that. So I eventually went back and it introduced itself as George and he was the doctor that supposedly haunts the centre. And ever since then, he's sort of stuck with me. He doesn't do anything. He just, every time we come on the board, he monopolises it.
He doesn't know where we are, though, does he?
Yeah, apparently Lucy said that he doesn't know where we were.
Right, yeah, sort of. And sort of once Paul's on the board, I mean, that's it, really. It's George all the way, isn't it?
Yeah, it
does seem to be. And that is something that we are going to have to explore external of an event and, you know, see if... Luce?
We gave the board to Jason towards the end of the night because I was like, is it just Paul, basically, on this, you know, does it react to Paul or is it the board or whatever? So I gave the board to Jason and I went, go do a Ouija board session, come back and tell me what you've got. Jason, what did you get?
Yeah, because we didn't know what we were looking for. Lucy didn't tell me anything. She said, go see what you get. We got a sister, a lady come through and she was very, she kept on saying, I'm sister. So I was like, sister to what? And she kept on saying there was a gentleman around the board or a gentleman around there that wasn't nice, and she was kind of blocking him from coming forward. Now, he was trying to say that all we were getting things like he was 91 year old and things like that, but she was very forceful of that. This guy is not coming through. So I said to, because I was doing it with John at the time, and I said, like, let's just go speak to Lucy and say, tell her what we've got, because she's not getting anything of this lady's blocking it. So we just went and said, this is what we've got. We've got this sister lady. There's a guy definitely on this board, but this lady's blocking it. Now, we don't know if she's attached to the venue or if she's attached to the board as well or what. We didn't know. We just said she's just very, very forceful that we can't go any further. And it was always her that kept on jumping back in.
Apart from when me and Andy went on, it just went flat, so then, didn't it?
Yeah, we swapped, didn't we? Yeah, yeah. As soon as me and John got off there, that's when I said that we'll give it to you, didn't we, and see what you got.
Yeah, and it just stopped then.
That's interesting because this person doesn't answer to women either.
No.
So it's different how you've had the same experiences as what we've had.
Yeah.
Then Lucy came in and did the board around. Well, they did the board, but Lucy was with them with John and stuff, and he did then come through more stronger, didn't he? So I thought that was quite interesting because at first this sister lady, whoever she was, it was like she was trying to protect us from something. It was very strange because
she was like a nun, wasn't she? That's what I was getting.
That's what we were questioning. When she said sister, we were saying, is it a nun? Is it a nurse? Is it, you know, who are you? And she pointed towards a nun. So yeah. I don't know who she is, or if she's connected to Nettie's Head or Haunted Antiques or whatever. But she's around and she's trying to look out for people.
It's 91 come through before, because that came through a few times, didn't it?
Yeah, we got that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we. Oh, was it?
It didn't come through on the night when we were doing it, Richard. No. But you've got to understand, this board has come up with stuff quite a lot. On other occasions.
Is the 91 associated to the woman?
We're not sure. We just asked, can you give us a date or an age of who you are? And he just kept on going at 91 all the time.
It came through on that second session, though, isn't it? After Lucy'd come through, we got 91 again then, I think. I was recording this, so I can check it.
Okay.
What is really interesting is how certain people get on the board and it goes dead, and other people who are linked to Paul get on the board and it works. It's very, very strange. Now, Anna, you're very sceptical-minded in regards to, you know, you like to know how things work and what they do and stuff like that.
I certainly do.
What's your opinion of a Ouija board?
I am open-minded. I will use them. I wouldn't necessarily. There's part of me that wouldn't trust the evidence from one unless I could perhaps corroborate it with maybe some other equipment going off. I think, but I am the sort of person that can talk myself out of anything. So, you know, I could have something super amazing in front of me and I'll probably go, well, it just couldn't be, could it? But yeah, I it's not that I wouldn't use one, and it's not that I wouldn't sort of, if something interesting, I wouldn't just dismiss it out of hand because I'm sceptical. I would keep an open mind, but I wouldn't just go with what came through on a board, if you see what I mean.
So what's your opinion on this situation that Paul's got with his Ouija board, with this George character coming through and this scenario going on? How would you deal with that?
Well, interesting, because Lucy said it happens on her board as well. I think, was it your board as well, Lucy, and you got that from Harpic?
Yeah, there's two, yeah.
Yeah, because my first thought was, oh, perhaps I should buy a board from Harpic and see if that happens to mine. But then I thought, well, then I've got that in mind if I used it, so I'd have to get somebody else to use it and not tell them that's what I was doing. But yeah, that was my initial thought. Buy a board and see if it happens on that. Yeah, I just like to test things and keep testing things. I think the more, I mean, because obviously I'd only seen that the once, so if I saw that happen repeatedly, I'd be more and more intrigued, and I'd be finding it harder and harder to find my sceptical opinion of it, wouldn't I?
Jason, having witnessed that and knowing now the history there, what would your opinion be? How would you move forward with that particular board?
I think it needs more work. There's done a lot of work already, but I think it needs documenting. Everything needs documenting for this. But I know Lucy was on about getting rid of the board. If that was to happen, I would personally put it in Harpic and leave it in there, because that's where it came from. But there's done a lot on it. I don't know. Maybe do a live or something so people can see it themselves, because I think you've got to see it to understand it. And I don't know if that's something that Paul would want to do, and so on your show.
I just want to point out that I'm not getting rid of the board.
Good. No, good, because there's so much more work that I'd like to do with you on that board. Because for me, this is fascinating to me. Now, is it an attachment to Paul himself and thereby Lucy? Because obviously Lucy and Paul are a couple together. So it could be that George is attached to Paul, but because she's so close to Lucy, that he then decides that that's a good link too. Or is it attached to the actual board? Is there an actual attachment? I don't know. It's a lot more work that would need to be done on that, which we have got planned, haven't we, Paul?
We have, yeah. We've decided a course of action, and George better be covering his ass.
I can't wait to go to an investigation where he doesn't come through at all.
Yeah.
It's just... Every time we go and we use it, it comes through, and it really, I know he's there and something, it really annoys me, and I know it shouldn't. And we know that you're around us, can you just leave us alone and step back for a bit?
Does he come through if you use other people's boards, or is it just literally those that you've got?
But he's done it at the HPR though, hasn't he? But then again, that's linked. That would be interesting when we go on our next investigation, see if he comes through.
Well, I'll be checking my board.
Yeah, because I think...
An investigation. Not my Luigi board, I'd like to add. My own personal board.
Not Luigi. I think, as you say, Kerry, it does need a lot more work specifically on that, as opposed to... When we go on an investigation, George is a bit of a nuisance, isn't it? You know, sort of get out of the way and let us carry on. But I think we need to devote a lot more time to George itself.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's exactly what needs to happen, to either clear him, get rid, or find out more information on it.
Yeah.
The problem is, as well, when we tried finding out more information about him,
he just goes quiet.
He doesn't like talking about some of the things in his past. He's very tight-lipped when it comes to stuff like that. So to find out any actual information where we can actually look him up is going to be very difficult.
And good luck.
We can but try, folks. We can but try. But it is an interesting case study that is going forward. And very interesting that it's come up again, even though it was on a completely different paranormal investigation, different location completely. And he's appeared again. So it was on the live we were doing at the time. It was like, oh, for God's sakes, George is in the room. Oh, my God. But great that it was passed to the West Yorkshire team to see whether they got anything I think that's a fascinating aspect that, you know, was needed to be explored. Does it come up for other team members? Because then that would suggest it's the board.
Yeah.
And maybe like test it with other ladies on it as well. So see if the same happens like it did to me and Andy, that nothing happens at all, and see if you consistently get that. That'd be interesting as well.
Yeah, because when I was on the board with two other ladies on the night, that went completely dead as well. Literally nothing. The minute the boys got on it, no problem.
I think I'll have to do the live, I think, first. So we'll see.
Yeah. Maybe. We was live doing that at Nettie's Head. So, again, go back to the Paranormal Concept page. You'll be able to check that out. So, all in all, we've got a location where it felt very atmospheric in places. We had minor, what I class as minor phenomena, little things, nothing major, no massive long sessions with a spirit per se. Would we agree with that?
Yeah.
I still think though that there is something there, because I mean, even I'm probably the first person to say that phone apps I wouldn't necessarily agree with them, but one of our team members, they actually come out of a word about 30 seconds before the paratech thing did, and it came out with the same word. I think it was a name, if I remember rightly.
I think it was, yeah. I'm not too sure what the name was.
Either.
Was that Margaret?
No.
Was that Rose? Because those are the two names that came out.
What was the other name?
Rose.
No, there was something else. It was, yeah, Tara was the one that came out with it, literally a couple of seconds before the paratech.
It was the surname, I think.
Oh, the Atherton.
It was the Allerton, and it took us a while to get the surname right.
Yeah,
wasn't it?
That's the one. Because she read it out. She said it first before the paratech.
Because she said Allerton, and then I went, do you mean Atherton? And she went, yeah. And then it came through and paratech, didn't it?
Which was quite an interesting thing, really.
I do think there's something there. I think, I don't know whether we were the first ones back in there from like this massive lockdown that the UK's had, but it just felt like there was loads of things there that we were being watched. And they were stepping back. I think they were watching what we were doing and they were intrigued. So it would be nice to get back.
Maybe the spirits were holding their human investigation.
Do you think then that because there has been this extended lockdown, so a lot of locations now have been rested. Now, we talk about over-investigating a place and the spirits getting fed up with it, but they've had the lockdown too. They had a time where there was nobody other than the volunteers or whoever going in just to keep it safe, do you know what I mean, and do the necessary cleaning and stuff like that, but not working psychically or spiritually or, you know, investigating in any way. They're just part of the building themselves, really, aren't they? Do we think then that they're a little rusty, that their energy levels need to be raised up a little bit?
I do actually go along with that sort of train of thought. I believe that as a museum, it would have been used to having lots of people. I believe that sort of places, they can perhaps charge up during the day as people come and go and do their daily business and then discharge at night when there's nobody about. Well, apart from us paranormal investigators. And I believe that perhaps, if anything, Nettie said could have been a victim of that. It just hasn't had a charge, a prolonged period of inactivity has affected the possible psychic activity.
You say that, but you're assuming that the spiritual realm is on the same timeline as we are.
Here we go, Skeptismo's coming in, sorry.
Time might not affect them the same way it does us.
Energy does.
I would
argue that, Paul. I don't think it's anything to do with time. I think it's to do with energy level. and there's been an extended period of time where there hasn't been the energy of, like Paul says,
by an extended level of time. We've had a year and a bit out of investigating, and you're assuming that the spirits have had a year and a bit out of time of investigating. What I'm saying is they might have just thought, well, let's leap ahead a bit and just instantly gone to the end. Well, I'm done.
No.
Time might not work the same way it does for us.
But energy does.
Yeah, but
when you've had a lull in energy for an extended period of time, that could be an effect.
Yeah, but you still don't
know. You don't know. I don't know. It's a thought.
Energy, again, works in different ways. So you don't exactly know what type of energy it is. We call it spirit energy, but we don't know what energy source it is.
Anyway, it was just a thought. Jason, Anna, what do you think about that?
Well, I work in a museum as well, and I would say during lockdown, our museums is more active now than it has ever been.
Really? Interesting.
We're getting things all the time. It's so much so that some of the staff members won't even turn the lights off anymore. They'll wait till I do it. So we get a lot of stuff in there, which is, I don't know if it's because it's quieter that we're noticing more stuff. But for us, it seems to be, since lockdown, there's not many people around. It's settled a little bit, but then it's picked up twice as much. So I don't know.
Thing is, I've noticed the opposite at the library, because the library, I thought that might have, because obviously that's got its own sort of ghosts. But it, to me, is feeling much more comfortable, which is a sort of atmosphere used to get the more people were in it, even though there's less people in it. And we've had sort of building work done as well during lockdown, and it's not really stirred anything so much up. Unless I've just become completely deadened to everything now, which I'm slightly concerned about.
No, I don't think so. I don't know. It's a very strange one, isn't it? Yeah.
But you know, like that thing about being in tune with things, because like, obviously I've not been in the library that much, so I'm not as in tune with it as I was.
Yeah, maybe because you're not open to it, that it's happening a bit, you're noticing that it's happening a bit more, maybe.
Yeah, it's sort of bit, I've been thinking about this, because obviously it sort of goes down the realms of the things that I would say that I don't usually subscribe to, but I do think about. So I've been thinking, am I no longer in tune with that? Am I not picking up on these atmospheres that I used to pick up on? I think it's an interesting concept.
Just out of curiosity, was you furloughed, Anna?
I was flexi furloughed, so we were going in at one point only for 4 hours a week. So during the last lockdown, I was going in for 4 hours, and we were so busy doing the day-to-day things and trying to get everything done in 4 hours that I had no time to notice anything else, to be honest. But my colleague, Jane, she used to not be bothered to go down to the basement, and I used to be scared witless of it. And I would go down, and she wouldn't go down, so I don't know.
And Jason,
that's also intriguing.
Yeah, Jason, were you furloughed, or was you in every day?
Councils, so we were paid all the way through, so we were on call to go in and do billing checks. We've got two sites to check, so we was in all the time cleaning and making sure that there's someone in every day to make sure there was somebody on site, and make sure that no one's trying to break in.
It's an interesting thing, though, isn't it? It's one of those, isn't it? You can't call it either way, whether, you know, lockdown had an effect or not, or whether or not it was us that it had the effect on more, which is why we had trouble, I suppose you'd call it. Nettie said, possibly. Yeah. I don't know. I'm playing devil's advocate on this one. I don't know the answer to the question any more than Paul does.
I think that's a good point, though, because I know that lockdown has affected me, because I think it affected a lot of people, even if it's not like a major effect, you know, but you sort of, just that not being able to go out, not being able to do things, it does have a bit of a dampener on the on your happiness, basically, doesn't it? And just on your, in general, which then if you're trying to go out and pick things up, perhaps that's kind of like a bit of an inhibitor.
I don't know. Lucy, did you find it an inhibitor?
I don't know, really.
Do you feel you was more in tune or less in tune than you possibly would have been on an investigation, this is?
I felt I was more rusty than ever before, but I think that is because we've had so much time off, even though I do meditate quite a lot, but I just felt... And I think we all said this, we did feel completely rusty.
Yeah, I felt rusty.
It took us a while to recover because it took us a week, whereas before it only take like a couple of days. So I think that has an impact as well. But is that the energies? Is it your energy? I don't know.
It's a hard one to call, isn't it? Because it's so individual.
Is it because we're not used to it? It's one of them.
It is. Very interesting, though, to see going forward how things ramp up as we do more investigating.
Yeah,
100%. We've all got other events coming up in various ways at various locations. And once you get back into the swing of it and you start, you know, your brain starts to click back into investigation mode. And whether or not the more we do it again, or the better question, and better it becomes.
Yeah. Or the other question was, with us, was stuff happening on the night that we were just missing it? Because we're used to it.
Exactly. Yeah. So what I think would be very interesting is hopefully we'll be able to continue opening up and not be shut down again. That in, say, 6 months' time, if we went back to Nettie's Head, how different it would be then.
I'm up for that.
I would like to go back just to see if there's a difference.
There was also a lot of traveling for the first one back as well. We did spend a lot of time traveling there, so that's tiring as well to go up to a location like that. First one back, we 5 hours to get down there. And then
were you tired traveling to the location?
I wasn't tired traveling to the location. Coming back, it's a good job our Viv lives in half between. She lives at the halfway house and we had to stop.
Yeah.
And I never do that. I usually do the full trip.
So it's a location that's incredibly fascinating. It's a fantastic location, guys. I'm not going to deny that. All I would say is that going forward, for us as teams, we would like to go back once we've been a little bit more seasoned again, I think is the expression, just to see the difference. Because even when we got to an EVP session, for example, it was like, right, we're going to do an EVP session. Now, I have done hundreds of EVP sessions in my time. I don't know about you guys, but I know I've done quite a few in my time. And I kind of turned the recorder on, and I kind of went, oh, hello, is anybody there? I kind of think it was such a rookie moment. I was like, do you know what I mean? So it definitely had, I feel, that was more impactful than anything else. And it's going to be very interesting in the next few investigations coming up as we start to flex our investigation muscles again.
I think it'd be interesting to do, Nettie said, this time, the same time next year to see if we get the same.
Yeah, once we've seasoned ourselves a bit more. Yeah. Definitely. So that's pretty much the investigation at RAF Nettie's Head that we did. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to be talking to Anna and Justin. Jason again. And, you know, find out a little bit more about those guys and how, you know, up to pre-lockdown, things were going for them. So join us right after this.
Hello, Harry Price here. If there's nothing me and my friends enjoy more here on the other side, it is to sit back and relax and listen to the Paranormal Concept Show right here on the PAUK Radio Network. Broadcasting a plethora of interesting and informative content for all your paranormal needs. Find them across social media to keep up to date with forthcoming shows and all their other adventures. Hello, is there anybody there?
And welcome back to the Paranormal Concept Show, exclusive to the Paranormal UK Radio Network. Now, in the break, we had a little private little chat with the guys from West Yorkshire Paranormal. Now, we talked all about RAF Nettie's Head, but I want to explore a little bit more about their own personal paranormal journey that they've been on. Now, who founded the team? That was Jason, right?
Yeah, it was me, yeah.
So why did you want to start your own team?
It was just one of them things, you know. I was very much into the paranormal, first of all, from Ghostbusters. I mean, who didn't, you know? Ghostbusters got me going. And then with my first wife, I moved into a house, and she was saying it was haunted, and I was like, you stupid idiot, don't be, you know. I don't see a thing. And it happened about four times. Then we had a roommate move in with us, and they experienced it as well. And I was like, they're taking the piss out of me. But it actually happened to me, and that really got me interested in the paranormal thing, because there was something walking up my stairs. Cold breeze went past me, and the dog ran away. And I was just like, oh dear, something's here. And since then, I was like, right, I'm going to stay up all night. I'm not scared of anything. I'm going to stay up all night and listen for this thing, and nothing happened. But I wanted to know what was there, what was on the other side. So I want to sit on my own team. It can't be that hard. And it actually was very hard. I sat in a pub for many months interviewing people to join the team. And I've never met so many crazy people in my life, you know. Stuff they were coming out with, I was like, I'm going to get murdered if I stay with you. And then it just started to gel. We started getting some really good people in the team. And it just went from somewhere little in Farnley, where I was, just people from around Farnley area, to right across Leeds. And it's just got bigger and bigger. And we've got people from all over now. So, yeah. And then Anna joined about three years ago.
Was four. It four. Years
ago? Get it right, Jay. Get it right.
I know we lost a year last year, but
well, there you go. Then. See, you know. I went to the library, spent a long time trying to get in the library, and this time the reply to my email. And
that's because I was like, yes, let's get them in, because I was really interested, and we'd experienced some stuff, and when I heard there was a team wanting to come investigate, I was like, oh, can we let them?
Yeah, and bless her, we did. And when I first met Anna, she was terrified to go in the basement there.
I was.
And but now she's not, which shows improvement. So it's good. But yeah, we've gone on really well, and we joined the Taps family a few years ago, and we don't really get many cases at the moment from them. But now they're back on TV with the Ghost Hunters coming up.
Although we've got plenty of our own anyway, haven't we?
Yeah. We've got a lot of clients. So we do private houses, lots of private houses. And just before lockdown, we was probably the busiest time we've been in a few years. I think we had about 12 to 15 in a row that were coming. And there seemed to be every other day there was someone else asking for help. And then lockdown came, and then we couldn't go to anybody. And we had spent the entire lockdown on the phone, talking to these people as much as we can, and hoping that we can help them from there. But it's been so hard. It's been difficult.
I can imagine doing a private case and helping people over a phone line. It is incredibly challenging.
And unfortunately, it's the first time it's ever happened to us, but one of these people actually had to move out of the home, which it's for us is upsetting, because we don't want people to feel that way. And they've moved out, and well, he's still in contact with us, and they're still getting things going on, so it might actually be attached to them. So, you know, we'll have to keep an eye on that one. But unfortunately, one person had to move out, because they said it was so bad that they had a little boy to think about, and off they went. So
that's a lost opportunity, isn't it? Because it could have been a South Shields poltergeist type scenario, and you can't do anything. You can't go and document it.
Yeah. What we're finding as well is, and we always say it's a big no-no, is people are out now starting, these people and other people I've spoken to from other teams, that people are now starting to investigate their own home, which I'm thinking, that's something you don't really want to do. You live there, so don't be doing that.
And we had one, didn't they? And they were literally recording everything and then watching it the following day.
Yeah, all night. Mm. Yeah, it's not healthy. It's really not. And so, yeah, that's where we're at.
And don't forget, we got an office as well.
Oh yes, we got. Oh, we were very lucky to. We did a few locations. It was my cousin owned some bars, and they were actually getting a lot of hauntings in these bars. So they asked us to come round and investigate, and they've just opened another one. And he says to us, "I've got an extra floor. Do you want an office?" And we were like, "Yes, we'll have an office." There we go. You know, so we get a lot of. In that area, we get a lot of clients, so it's better especially COVID as well, is instead of us feeling uncomfortable going to someone's house straight away, that they can actually come and speak to us in the office or around that area. So it's because you don't know how people are going to react now for us going into the houses. It's all changed. Everything's changed. So it's
and I think it gives them that chance to speak about it, not being in that environment as well. So I think that's better for them.
Yeah.
So when you are doing private cases, how do you approach that?
Well, they approach us. We have a how we work is, first of all, we do a telephone consultation with them. We then arrange a meeting with them face to face just to go over anything. And then we have people in the team who go out, as a gentleman called Harry, who's had a lot of training in prisons with probation. He used to be a probation officer in prisons, so he's dealt with everything, illnesses and everything. So he picks up the signs and tells us if it's actually paranormal or not.
He tends to do the sort of secondary interview, doesn't he? I'll do the initial telephone, and then he does the secondary interview, sort of, and you know, watches for body language and things like as well. So he's totally on all that.
Yeah, and he's actually really good with them. He does spend a lot of time with them, and if he feels that it's more than paranormal and they need help, he sends them that way or who to speak to, because he has all the contacts, which it's great for us, you know, because there's things that I wouldn't even have a clue where to start, you know, and say you need to go speak to this person. This is how you do it. He knows. He goes and does it. I've got contacts. Here you go. You can go speak to this person. And it's been really helpful for us. And then we do the investigation. Once we've done it, we go back to the client. We deliver the evidence and say, this is what we've got and what they think about it. And then it's up to them what they want to do next. We don't just go in and say, we're going to start getting your house cleansed for you and things like that. Because we don't know what, first of all, if we've got anything or if it's someone who's actually connected to them. So we show them, they listen to it, they get an understanding of what we've got. And then it's entirely up to them what happens next.
I have noticed, though, from doing the sort of initial phone interviews, there's a lot of people that are now starting to try and cleanse their own homes because they've looked it up online. Mm-hmm. And they're all sort of saging the homes. But obviously, you don't really know what they're doing. You don't even know if they need to do that. But the sort of that's like a go-to thing for people now because they've seen it on TV.
And there is a process to it that mm-hmm. is not really totally covered.
Mm.
You know, one thinks that it's just a question of waving some sage around, but there's a bit more to it than that, really.
Yeah.
And if you miss it out, then it's not really going to be particularly effective. So do you think then that there's too much influence from media or internet?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think it's a scary thought as well as what... When you go in there and then you're there talking to you and you're thinking, why am I here? you know all this stuff. Why are you asking me questions? I think they like to double check things. You know, I think and some people weirdly want their house to be haunted.
Yes, it is.
And what annoys me the most is when you go there and you have the neighbors or the mates coming round and it's like a party. The paranormal team's here. And it's not what we're about. We're not there to put on a show. We're there to find out.
And it's obviously very difficult to investigate when you've got that.
Yeah.
You've got them there because you've got too much noise and too many people.
It's also difficult as well as when you're thinking, get rid of your neighbour and you'll be fine. Because sometimes the neighbours and stuff are feeding them so much stuff that when you're listening to all this, you're thinking, crikey, out loud, get rid of that person. You'll be absolutely fine. Don't listen to them.
Well, again, we had one that the neighbour was watching from across... They lived over the road and they were watching and sort of saying, I've seen this and I've seen that.
Yeah, they were watching things like when they're in the bedroom and stuff. I mean, come on, you must. I mean, I stood across that road and I was thinking, you need binoculars to see through that window, you know.
isn't there laws against that?
Well, yeah, it's very worrying, you know. And then you're going back and you're saying this, this and that to them. I'm thinking, first of all, why haven't they knocked you out, first of all, for looking through the window? it's not great. So that's, I think when we actually do get back out, we've got a long list of people to contact again and see what the situation is. We got to a point where we actually slowed it down, contacting them in lockdown because the lockdown was just getting bigger and longer that We were just saying the same thing over and over again. We can't come out. We can't come
and
out.
And we had the brief period where we thought, like, some areas when they eased it before, we could have gone out to. And then the ones where we had clients, they'd gone into sort of mini lockdown. So then we had to say, oh, no, we can't come out. And it was just really hard.
Yeah. I think there was one that we were going to go on a Friday. And on the Thursday, it went down on lockdown, didn't it, again? And we was like, oh, we can't. So I had to bring it back and say, we can't come out. it's not fair on them. It must play on the mind all the time. Whether or not it's haunted, we don't know until we get there. It's entirely up to them what happens next. But we try our best. That's all we can do.
Because you've gotten so many cases, Jason and Anna, do you think lockdown, and because people are having massive amounts in their own time, are starting to notice things that they wouldn't necessarily usually notice? Do you think some of it comes from that?
Oh, yeah, definitely, I think. Yeah, because you normally get people in from 9 till, you know, they come out at 5 o'clock, they're too tired, they have food and they go to bed. Now they're in all day and then they start talking about it. Which they actually start talking to real people. I'm dealing with one where an elderly person's using her granddaughter to speak to us because she's terrified. And she's noticing all the time, so much so that the granddaughter's now going around all the time to stay there. So I think, it's definitely picked up a lot because people have been at home all the time, not being able to go shopping. But it's also, is it paranormal? Is it the mental health? It's a big thing we've got to be looking at when we go
and
back out.
It's the influence of a lot of the paranormal shows as well, because people are so used to seeing it on TV that it's almost like the first thought is, I've heard a noise, it's got to be paranormal.
Yeah.
And I think that has a part to play as well.
We've had a situation down, and we had to, well, Paul, you know, being Paul, he knows it all and stuff like that. And I kept hearing the corner of the room clicking. I'd never heard it before in my life, but it was really loud clicks, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
Where Paul's sat now.
And it's a regular occurrence.
And it's basically when the flat calls down, but because I'd never heard of it in my life before. Yeah. I instantly thought, oh my God, like, I've got a bit of paranormal activity, and it's not, it's the walls calling down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I noticed a pattern with it, and it happened every so often.
No, it's just at the same times as well, and you're just like, wait a minute, I need to do it.
Yeah, it's not.
I just hope that people don't go out as well and say, you know, like a paranormal team goes to a house and then they say, what is it? It's a ghost, because they haven't been out for so long, they want it to be a ghost. Something there that they can have and they can work with.
Yeah.
I just hope that a lot of teams still do what they normally used to do and do it properly instead of getting too excited.
But then having said that, we have that client, don't we, that a team had gone out, and this is before lockdown hit, had gone out and done a live at the house.
Yeah.
And done a Ouija board session whilst they were supposedly doing a client, and it was just... And it's the redress. It was all on because it was on YouTube, wasn't it?
Yeah, and then she got a load of people knocking on her door, taking photos because the house was haunted.
You know, so we were dealing with the fallout from that one, but that's one we've not been able to go to, have is it? You know, because
So do you actually attend every call that comes into you?
Yes, every call, no matter if it's haunted or not, and we always have a motto in the team that if it's got any children involved, we will make sure that somebody in the team is either on the phone or with them within 48 hours to find out what's going on. And if we're on a case already and we feel it's urgent, then we'll send team members around there straight away.
Right, okay.
And we only take the most experienced team members as well. You know, because there's a lot of people interested in doing client cases, but obviously it's completely different. It's a completely different kettle of fish to do and just investigating a location. Yeah. You know, because you're dealing with scared people, and it's not just about the investigation, it's also about the reassurance. You know, sometimes people, it's a bit like me when Jason did the library, I said to him, I want you to tell me it's not haunted here. I want you to give me the rational explanations, and sometimes that helps by talking to people about the rational explanations. That helps.
Well, I'm sorry it was haunted. I couldn't help it.
I know. But I'm not scared anymore. I'm brave now.
How many do you think that you get that just literally want a TV series played out in their house?
I was just about to ask that one.
I would say about 80% of people just want someone to go out and say their house is haunted, and then next day it'll be on a TV show like, is it Help My House is Haunted, whatever it's called. It'll be on something like that. And
Well, we had one, didn't we? We've been out multiple times, and then again, that was because there were children involved. But the overwhelming sense was that
it's not haunted.
It's not haunted.
And we can't make it be haunted for you.
No.
We still go out because they say this has happened. Fine, we'll come have another look. But it now gets to the point where we've been out like 3 or 4 times. We then say, look, we're not getting anything for us to say that it's haunted and tough.
I must admit, I'm very much like yourself. I used to do that to all the cases that came into me. And then I thought to myself, well, sometimes, you know, they're wasting my time as well as their own. And I introduced a diary. I asked every case that came into me to fill in a diary of at least 2 weeks so I could then possibly see a pattern and then decide when the best time to go in would be.
Yeah, we do that as well. We ask them to do that.
And my cases dropped about 80%.
And there was one many years ago, this was about 5 years ago, we had one where this gentleman was really adamant that we went to his house on a certain time, at a certain day, and it just didn't feel right, you know. And in the end, I spoke to a couple of guys and I said, let's just not go. And I got a phone call about 2 weeks later from a social worker for this gentleman, and she said, she'd been looking through his diary and stuff, and she contacted us, and I said, yeah, we were going to come round. She said, it's a good job we didn't, because he was waiting with a knife when someone walked through the door. So, you know, you've got to be careful. You really are.
Yeah.
But it just didn't feel right. You know, when you get that feeling, you're like, this isn't right. We're not going.
And again, that's another advantage of now having the office space that we can get people to come to us.
Yeah, they can come to you, can't they?
Yeah.
Do you have anyone that's trained in mental health awareness on this then?
Yeah, we have Harry who does all that kind of stuff. So he knows about stuff like that. So he tells us he has this questionnaire that he speaks to them about, and you know he then comes to us and he does like a report of what he's spoke to and what he picks up and what he recommends. And 9 times out of 10, his report is saying that they've got mental health issues. And there's the odd person that he goes, but I still like to go talk. We still should go because I think it might have something else as well. So that's when we go and we have a look.
Excellent. Not many teams have got that in place.
No, it's good. It's good having him. He's not always around, which is a frustration. But we still, if he's not available, we still email him and send him what we spoke to him, and then he can then email us back and say, this is what I would recommend you guys do. So it's good to have. It's a blessing, really, because like I said, many teams don't have it. And I think it's a lifesaver, you know, because it gives you that option of, it's not paranormal, but this is the options that it definitely will be. So there we go.
So how do you get cases actually come to you? Do you advertise as such?
We don't advertise for clients at all. I didn't feel like that's what a paranormal team should do. If someone needs help, they'll come to you. Mm-hmm. And they come through Facebook. We have a website page. And
most of them come through Facebook, don't they? And then the remaining come through the website.
Yeah. You do get some odd people that you're reading it thinking, I don't know what that means. But you get people who are very pressurized of us speaking to them, and they've definitely got mental health issues and they're just desperate for someone to talk to. And like I said, Anna, there's only so many messages we can actually put to these people, and we just got to let it go, you know. Just be as nice as possible, say we're busy. Luckily, lockdown's been a blessing, because you can say, due to government guidelines, we can't come to your house. So that's
you helpful. Want to bring up now and say it's all good.
So going back to your investigation, like normal investigations, not private investigations, let's talk on the paranormal circuit of investigations. Jason, what was your very first one?
Almy Mills near me. Almy Mills is... Well, it's a museum. It's massive. It's where all the
it's the Gott family.
Gott family cotton. They used to do cotton and wool, and they've still got the machines running. Do you know where the kids used to go underneath them and clean them all and stuff?
Uh-huh.
It's absolutely massive mill, and
it's now Leeds Industrial Museum.
Leeds Industrial Museum, yeah. It's a very big place. It's a very eerie place if you look at it from a distance. And when I saw that, it was with an event company, and I thought, I'm going to go do this. I'm going to go do it, and I got right excited because I thought, you know, I'm going to investigate. I'm going to stack some chairs on top of each other and see what happens. And I went off, and these chairs were next to each other on the floor. And I was like, oh my God, look at that. And I was like, so excited, running around, really going, look at this, the chairs have moved. And then someone said, oh yeah, I sat down on them. So I was like, you bastard. But yeah, that was my first one. And I just didn't look back from there. And then I started working in museums and actually doing the ghost nights when the event companies come around. And being the staff member and seeing the whole, you know, all different teams work and stuff. So that helps a lot because I got to speak to a lot of people and meet a lot of people and learn who's good and who's not so good, you know. So it's been an eye-opener for me.
Yeah, when we spoke to Jay and Teresa Lynch, they'd worked with a lot of teams before they'd sort of like taken the plunge themselves, really. And they said the learning experience was invaluable.
Yeah, it is.
Working with other teams and getting a vibe for how to do different ideas and different experiments and stuff like that. What kind of things did you take from that period of time forward in your own team?
First of all, I was looking at how they investigate, you know, because what you look on TV is like half an hour, and realizing that it's not all, it happens now. It's, you know, you are sat on the floor for a long time, and you really got to have some patience for this. And just listening to how they spoke to them and how and what kit they used and things like that, and then coming away from that thinking, okay, I like that, but I want to add this little bit to it. See, I don't like using the word spirit. I hate it. You know, I just never have liked using it. I just want to speak to them like normal people. And and when they all say, "Come on, spirit," I'm like, "Don't say it." You know, I hate that. And so I came back and I said, "Look, I want my team, if possible, not to say that, and let's treat them like human beings, and let's see what we get that way." And we still do that now. We don't say spirit, you know. Hardly anyone in the team says it, you know. We want to treat them like human beings and see what we get, you know. And even now, I look around when teams come to the museum, I'm always looking and nosing and what they're doing, you know, because you can get in a rut of doing the same thing all the time and not learning new things. So I like to look at other teams and see what they get.
Mm-hmm. Anna,
what's been the best team that you've worked with?
Ooh. Oof, oof. You've got to say us now.
Well, you guys, you know.
Yay! You guys.
For me, though, we came and it was just like we'd worked together forever, you know. It was there was no fighting over who was going where. It was just all naturally flowed together.
Yeah.
And I've worked with teams that doesn't happen, you know. They want to be the bee's knees and want to be in the front, but there was no egos on, was it last Saturday, and it works really well, you know. I don't really know any other teams that I would say that I liked.
I like
all it happening, you know, because I worked in New Zealand. I got to know them quite well, and when I went to do Newton Park with them, they kind of says, you know, we know who you are, you can go off on your own, which is fine. Do you know what I mean? So that was nice, you know, because they trust you, and I like working with them. But that's about it. Some teams that I will avoid, and if their name comes on the museum board there, they've got a ghost night, I'll try and avoid that very much. So book a holiday. Yeah, that's all I'll say on that.
Anna, what stage was it after the library investigation that you joined the team?
It was, yeah. And while they were there, I just asked lots and lots of questions, and I was quite enthusiastic, just because I'd always been interested but never thought about joining a team. And I didn't really have friends who would have gone to the events, so I never went to the events either. So I was super duper chuffed when Jason said, "You've got to come out." I was like, "Yes." I mean, the first location I went to was pretty rubbish, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was a community centre, but that didn't put me off, because it is because I kind of like, I like that whole the ghost hunter style, that where you're trying to look for the rational explanations first before you, you know, going, oh, there's something paranormal. And I just like that approach, which is the way that our team works. So it just all felt really great for me. And then the second place I went to was it was Sunderland Air Museum. Apart from the library, it was the first place I'd experienced actual sort of activity. I've been hooked ever since.
Yeah, what a place that is.
It is absolutely fantastic, and I'm really looking forward to it because we're going again.
How often do you go out? Do you go out like once a month? Is that the goal? Or is
we try to go out 3 or 4 times a month if we can. It's
kind of a mixture, isn't it, of like the paid locations and trying to do some sort of obviously cheaper locations and now certainly outdoor locations, because it all starts mounting up if you're not careful.
Oh gosh, yeah, it's not a cheap hobby, is it?
It's not.
Particularly when you factor in like your insurances and your kit and stuff like that. Anybody who says that this is a cheap hobby is lying. They're lying to you, folks, is all I'm going to say.
But it's money well spent.
Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong, because that's what we do. But then any hobby, you can invest a lot of money in, can't you?
You can. We had before COVID hit, and we had like a you know, we started now where we're programming the whole year, well, year and a half in basically. And we had a mixture of the client investigations, paid locations. We also had some events because we got partnership with the library to run some events for them so they could earn some money. Because I was like, oh, I know a handy team that can do that for you. And so we were going to do, I think we were initially going to do 4 of those a year to see how it went. And then we had a few other locations. We were going to do like charity events for them. There was Heron Corn.
Locked in Games, which is like an escape room, but they're always short on money. So every Halloween we go in for them and they sell our tickets, and we just do a ghost night from around the building, and they keep all the money and just give us some coffee and we're happy.
Oh, do tell me you get people to jump out at them on that one.
Oh, no, you don't need to. it's a good little place, you know, that. And it used to be a library as well, so a lot of libraries are haunted.
Yeah, I went in and was admiring the shelves.
That's a true librarian.
I know.
Look at the shelves. They're amazing.
Look at all the shelves, You get a lot of books on them. Lovely.
Yeah. Oh, look at the wood, solid wood. Nice. We had quite a lot of, you know, programmed in. And then, of course, we've just been reshuffling ever since. And then we're sort of easing back in, and we don't want to program too much in. One, because everybody's now going out, meeting the family, going on holidays and all those sorts of things as well, because everybody's trying to cram in all the things that they've missed. So this year is not quite as populated as it has been in previous years, but it's mainly to factor that in.
I think the calendar changes every month, doesn't it, Anna?
it does, and I've got a few more I'm working on.
Yeah, and there's things like the market. We just got the Leeds market, which no one's ever done before, and we were so lucky to get in there. And then COVID came, and it's been pushed back, and we've now got to organise that all again. So
yeah, because we went to Sportsman, didn't we? We sort of like wowed them with our enthusiasm and expertise, and they said, oh yeah, you know. So I mean, it was brilliant because nobody's done it, and it's such a huge location. It's the largest indoor market, I think, certainly was in Europe. And parts of it are really quite old. Even the ones where the 1909 hall we were going to investigate first.
Yeah.
But I was chatting to the guy because I did a second meeting with him, and they were saying that parts of it certainly underneath date much older. So it's all very, very intriguing. But we've got to get a date for that back in.
This is the problem that we've now got, isn't it? It's like we've wiped out pretty much, 14 months of an investigation calendar. And all those teams that had booked for that period of time are now having to juggle and try and get in to locations that they'd booked or planned, you know. And it's a juggling act at the moment, isn't it? And trying to get anywhere on the paranormal circuit is challenging. So it is finding those locations that haven't been investigated before, which has always been a bit of a chore, hasn't it, Paul?
Yeah, it's definitely, yeah.
But are you finding it easy to do that between you two?
No. No, I think the worst part is you're not, like I said, does every paranormal team in the UK is now trying to get their space back, which they've lost of these locations. And some of these locations are sold out every week, and it's where can we fit in? Are they going to go in this year? Are they going to go back next year? And then we've got the problem is we don't want too many close together that are all far away, because we've got to get hotels. And we've had instances this year where we've had hotels which, you know, someone hadn't cancelled in the team, unfortunately, and they've had to pay for them. It's difficult, you know, it's hard.
I suppose you have to sort of like, it's like starting afresh, isn't it? Starting again.
Then you always forget that location. Like, there's one that you paid for deposit for, and you, then you think, oh, we haven't done that. And you're looking at calendar thinking, we haven't fit that one in. Where's that going to go?
But
and...
don't worry, it's on my spreadsheet.
All right. There we go.
Anna is definitely the organisation of this team. I would just like to point that out. She is super organised kind of girl. Now, we've said before, Anna, that you're very tech-minded. You know, you like your tech side of things. What's your favourite out of all the tech that you've used and tried, and why?
I like my tech, but I'm also sceptical of my tech as well. Just, you know, so I like to, don't like to be. I like to keep testing the tech that I've got. So something I've been doing recently, I bought a new little piece, which Jason thinks is rubbish. and he keeps telling me it. And it wasn't cheap either. But I bought a piece of tech, and it's supposed to test air pressure. And it's supposed to be, I'd say supposed to be, it's what I'm testing. It flashes orange if it's, it detects an atmospheric condition that's supposed to align with low levels of paranormal activity. Purple if it's sort of large amounts, like taps and bangs and things like that. It has yet to correlate with anything.
It just bloody flashes all the time, that thing. It's like ghost.
Well, it flashes amber all the time. It doesn't flash purple all the time. But the thing is, I also now want another piece of kit that actually does test atmospheric pressure, that I can see what the figures are, because I don't know what that piece is calibrated to. So I like to get the tech to test it as well. Does it do what it's supposed to do? How can I test it? How can I prove it? As well as using it to do a paranormal investigation, so I can get a bit into it if I'm not careful.
I've always thought that about the K2 meter.
Yeah.
Because that, again, is just flashing lights, and it gives you a rough estimate of what the EMF force is.
Yeah.
They don't give you an accurate reading.
Yeah.
And it's the accurate reading you need, really, to be able to definitely say...
Yeah.
Whether or not there is a spike there at all.
I mean, I bought another piece of kit. It's which I tested for the first time at NETIZ, and we've determined that that's so sensitive. It's called a Q pod, but it's essentially a REM pod, but with four antennae. It's so sensitive. It was picking people up as they walked past in the corridor through the wall.
Yeah,
so we've determined that that's absolutely useless unless it's in a locked off room that nobody's walking past.
Yeah.
That'd
be ideal in a hall, wouldn't it? Really?
That detector does coming down the opposite side of the stairs.
Yeah.
If you put it in the centre of a hall, maybe.
But you'd have to have absolutely nobody going near it, because it was literally.
If you locked that hall off, in like a ballroom type hall rather than a hallway. I think in the right setting that'd be okay.
Well, yeah, because it'd be great, because if you do have it in a room that nobody's going near and it goes off, then that'd be really exciting. But
then will there be anyone else to monitor it?
We've got CCTV, though, so we could set that up as well.
Okay.
So every investigation you do you use your CCTV?
Well, I only bought that during lockdown, so it hasn't actually been used that much, and I need to sort out... getting adapters so I can put them on tripods at the moment, because it is literally a CCTV system.
We had one, didn't we? But it took so long to set up all the wires and stuff that we was actually watching these people thinking, guys, we've been here an hour and you're still setting up CCTV, you know? So we found one which was Wi-Fi. It's very easy to plug in and just set this camera up, and it's all connected pretty fast. It took about 20 minutes, didn't it, to sort it all out?
Yeah, I mean, we've tested that and it's brilliant, a really clear picture. That.
Yeah.
Just one piece of advice with that. When you've got it up and running, Use all your equipment as well, because sometimes certain equipment interferes with the Wi-Fi signal.
Right.
So just test all your equipment just to see whether or not, if you're going to use something,
yeah,
if it interferes, you know what that is, basically. Because I found that when I first got my first CCTV gear.
Because that's it. We've not really had the chance to take it out and give it a good test much. Because, you know, we bought it, I think, probably used it twice. I think we've used it a few times at the office. But then we had minimal equipment there. So that's a good point. I shall do that.
So where do you obtain your equipment from? Do you sort of get it from actual sort of ghost hunt and hunting suppliers, or do you sort of go down like the hardware store and sort of adapt equipment that's sort of generally out there?
Well, for me, it's a mixture.
Yeah, we get a lot of it from sellers. But I always say to people, you know, if you want something, just go, you know, go look in B&A. If you want like a motion sensor, right, there's these
things. Yeah, motion sensors.
Go something motion center, you're paying about £25 online. £3.99 in B&M, same thing. You know, you've got to don't put go, you know, I always say to people, don't put go something. Like these cat balls, they were going from some places for like £7.99 for a cat ball. Yeah. You know, you can get three for £3 somewhere. Do you know what
it's saying? I got six for hardly anything at all on Amazon.
Yeah. It's just, you've got to be careful. And people who are new to the thing will keep putting paranormal equipment or ghost hunting equipment when they're looking for something, and they can get ripped off. So,
yeah.
But that said, I got fell foul of that, didn't I? Because I bought something, because I was buying something else that was being made by this company. And he's laughing at me, isn't he? And I was like, oh, that looks good as well. I'll tag it onto my order. And then when I finally came, and it came in the box, and I Googled it, I was like, I could have got that for £8.95. So, you know, it happens to the best of us. We get a bit spendy. We think, well, I'll have that as well while I'm ordering this.
Yeah.
But we should do our homework first.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm just as bad with crystals. I've got four spheres, all the same, because I like them. It's the magpie effect, isn't it? They're personal ones. Yeah, it's the magpie effect, I think. It comes into play. You think, oh, that looks good. Oh, that looks good. And then you just do it, don't you?
Yeah. You think you just think, well, you might as well. You're buying that. I'll just tag that on. Oh, damn it.
Yeah, right. So what's the furthest you've travelled for a location?
Hastings.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. Yeah, I don't think you can get much further south than Hastings.
No, we did the True Crime Museum, and stupidly, I don't know why, we drove all the way there in one day.
Well, you did. Some of us got hotel. Right,
okay. Okay. The stupid people in the team drove there, did the investigation, and drove back. So we was up for 24 hours, just over 24 hours. But what a place that was. True Crime Museum. I've never had activity like it anywhere. As soon as you walked in that place, it was just everything. Even the metal chairs in the base room when we're all inside the cave in, they were we could hear them moving, and we got it all on recording as well, of audio recording of the chairs moving. It was crazy.
I love that place.
Yeah, I love serial killers and stuff, so it was my place to go. But what it was worth it. It was worth the traveling. I was on such a buzz coming all the way back that the 6 hours, 7 hours drive or whatever, it didn't feel like it. So yeah, but I didn't go to the second one, and the guys went down there and didn't get as much, did you?
We didn't. No, because we were expecting great things, because I'd missed the chair moving, because we'd left a little bit earlier, being hardcore like you.
Don't leave, that's what I say.
I know, well, I was at the mercy, because I don't drive, so I was at the mercy of the drivers, you see. So I had to go when they left. So I was expecting great things, but we got some bits and pieces, but probably not quite as exciting as what you had. But it was still a great location. I'd definitely go again.
I'd go ahead.
I still haven't been to the all the bits and pieces surrounding. Every time we go down, we say, we'll do the castle, we'll see this, we'll see that, and we do the True Crime Museum and go home again.
I think you'd have to do a weekend. You'd have to go up on the Friday night, wouldn't you, and stay for a couple of nights up there and get a few places in while you're up there, because that whole area is just amazing.
Yeah.
Guys,
Yeah, no, I've been there a few times. True Coins Museum, yeah, I love that one. We've got quite a few bits of activity in there. Even one of our, a couple of our investigators were attacked and they had scratches on them. One of them blistered up in a pyramid shape, which is quite an interesting one. Yeah, no, True Crimes is really good.
We had a newbie going there. On the first 5 minutes, we sent him in the Chamber of Death. I was like, you want to join my team, you've got to be hardcore. So go in the Chamber of Death.
It's like a ritual, isn't it? You have to put new people in a room on their own.
Well, you know, you've got to get them terrified, yeah, on their first investigation. Yeah, it's the law. Right?
He said he saw a skull go across the wall when he was in there, and he quit, didn't come back.
Oh, right. Well, that's the way to do it, yeah. Toughen him up. Like,
he's not up to it.
That room, there's a fence that goes around, and I wanted to do a grid on the autopsy table at the head of the table that they used to do the, oh God, the death thing. They used to put people down on this table. Pardon?
Was it lethal injection chair?
Not the one as you walk in, but the one at the back in the...
The lethal injection bench where...
The bed. And I put a grid on there. Right, so I had to jump over the fence. I had permission, I'd just like to add. Right, so I jumped over the fence, and then as I was jumping back, I got caught on the fence. I was just like hanging there for ages. Can somebody help me? And they were all laughing so much. They couldn't get me off this poxy fence for ages. They just found it hysterical. And I was like, I was not impressed with that. But it was in that room that the triangular blister thing, not on me, but on the person, came up.
Yeah.
It was really weird. And when we looked into it, the injection is three different injections. Right. And it was around the area that they would have done it. Wasn't it? Am I thinking that right, Paul?
Yeah, it was. Because they had the syringes had three needles.
Mm.
And they were arranged in like a pyramid. You know, if you held three syringes with needles, that's where they would have been on the skin.
Fascinating place. So, guys, you've got all, you know, a huge amount coming up in the future. What is on your bucket list to do that you haven't got coming up?
Well, not yet, we haven't, but I want to do a boat and I want to do a lighthouse.
The lighthouse is pending, isn't it? I've fired off the email.
I'm trying to find a boat. I just want to go on a boat and a lighthouse. That's just me. I want to go on one. But yeah, I think that's my bucket list for coming up.
You've done an awful lot more places though, haven't you? I still not done Lancaster Castle, so I'd love to do that.
That's my favourite.
And I haven't done Galleries of Justice, so I'd love to do that. And then of course there's Newsom Park that potentially might get to do.
That's on the burner.
That's been worked on.
I could even get us a boat.
What?
I can get us a boat.
Do it.
Okay. I'll throw it up, send him an email.
And did you say you wanted to do the galleries, Anna?
I did.
Yeah. Leave it with us and we'll do some digging for that one as well.
just a boat. I'll be very happy with a boat.
Now, Lucy, you have done the galleries, haven't you?
Me, yeah, I've done the galleries, yeah.
And you had something very interesting happen to you there, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. I've done the galleries loads, but I've never had the experience I've had. We was in the dark cells. There's only one entrance in and out, and there's like a grid, like a oubliette underneath, and you can't get in that oubliette. It's locked off. Me and a friend of mine got stones pelted at us from nowhere. It was crazy that night. Really, really interesting. And nobody was around.
Interesting.
Now, the thing is, and I found this with paranormal investigation, you can go on 100 different investigations and not a lot happen. You catch the odd bit, not a lot happen. But then you have the investigation that stands out, that knocks the socks off you, that terrifies the life out of you, no matter how seasoned you are an investigator, and leaves you with more questions than answers. What's that investigation for you, Jason?
Probably two. My first visit to probably Sunderland Air Museum is where I saw my first apparition there, which was have you ever been there? Where it's got like, it's an aircraft museum, but it's got trams there as well from like Blackpool and stuff. And that whole night was just weird. It was just constant activity. We had stones thrown at us. And then I saw, looking out the window of one of the trams, I saw half a man, you know, just his top half of him, no legs or anything. And that gave me the wiggins a little bit. And then I went outside into the next hangar and a solid metal door slammed shut on us. And I was just like, oh, fuck this.
I'm going to have to mark this show as explicit, you know.
Sorry.
That's all right. You carry on.
That was because the metal door, when Keith opened the door for us to go in there, he actually really had to push it open and put bricks there to keep, you know, to keep it all where it was. And it just slammed shut on us. And I was just like, that's not possible. You know, that's a heavy door. And whatever's moved that door, I ain't walking past it to get back out. You know? Well, yeah, that was for me, was because everything was going on. Seeing the apparition, first of all, shakes you up and everyone's going, why don't you get a picture of it? And I'm thinking, you get a picture of a ghost. If a ghost, you're not going to take a picture of it. You're just going to stare at it. And then that happened. And then we were getting the stones thrown at us as well, the little nuts and bolts and stones as well, where the German spy is supposed to be in. So for us, it was, for me, it was just like, I can't handle this today. Just want to go get a coffee now. That for me was weird. And it really kind of realized that, you know, if they really wanted to do something to us, they've got some power up here that can do anything they want to us, and we can't even stop it. So there you go.
Mm-hmm. Anna?
I think for me, and obviously I've not done as many places, Jason, but the place that I was sort of like scared myself was the Old Nick at Gainsborough. And I'd sort of got a little bit cocky, and I was thinking, oh, I've done a few investigations now, I'm really brave now, I'm not as scared as I used to be. And I went, it was near the end of the night, and I was tootling off down to where the female cells were. And I tootled off down there, I was like, oh, I've had a look around, blah, blah, blah. I'm walking back up the corridor, and I just got this feeling of being watched. And I'm going, oh, don't be silly, Anna, don't be silly. But, you know, you can feel it. You sort of like, it does sort of just sets you, your fight or flight race, basically. But then I'm trying to talk myself out of it, going, oh, just in your head. And then right after that point, there was a massive loud bang behind me that we have not, well, I didn't go straight back down. I dashed around the corner and realised that I wasn't quite on my own, because it was a man from the team who was just around the corner. And I didn't know he was there. And he was like, don't you think you want to go back down and see if there's anything falling over? I was like,
No.
I did go back down very quickly. He didn't come with me, though, I have to say. And then we did check, because there was the upstairs level, we did go upstairs and ask everybody who was upstairs, had they dropped anything? Had, you know, had they moved a table? Had they done anything? Nobody had. So the only place that we couldn't get into, which I think is where the boiler room was, because it was locked, was a place that a bang might have happened that we couldn't see. But, yeah, it was like something had crashed over, but nothing had crashed over. I kept my torch on for the rest of the evening.
And Lucy, what about you?
The weirdest one for me, it was a couple of years ago, was at, oh my life, Ruffham Control Tower. And it wasn't so much as, and it was more a mediumistic experience that I had. I couldn't explain in the way I was feeling and why I was feeling it. So because I'd never had that, and I was on my own, and I didn't have my comfort blanket circle around me, so I ran out, and it's the worst thing I could have done. And I ran out and I went down the bottom of the stairs, like composed myself, because I didn't know why I was feeling these things. Went back up and found out what was happening and why I was feeling the way I was feeling because of this gentleman, because the plane that he drove, that he was trying to bring back home, he didn't get all the way home and it crashed. Mm-hmm. So I was picking up on him, but it was more the anger of him because he couldn't get the plane back, and he was more distraught because he'd crashed it. and he died through it as well. That was the reason why I was feeling that everybody in that room that came up after was going, oh, it's because Hitler's on the wall and there's loads of photos of Hitler around. And it wasn't, it was because of this individual person. And it was so lovely to finally tell his story and see what he needed to say. And I was fine because I actually went back to Ruffham a week later with you guys because I did it with a different team and I was able to go in that room and feel fine. But that's the only time where I've not really, like, I've run out of a room, should I say. I don't do that. But I just couldn't. I think it was more emotions that I couldn't control. I didn't know why I was feeling it and where it was coming from.
Okay. So, guys, we've all been doing this for quite a while now, haven't we? And we're all quite knowledgeable, I would say, about, you know, all things from various sides, the sceptical as well as the spiritual, as well as the tech, all sorts of things. We're quite well read. What advice would you give to anybody coming into the field?
Be patient. And go out and learn. Do you know, if you're coming out of the field, go to event companies, go to a ghost night, see if you like it first. Don't just jump in the deep end. And don't be afraid to ask other teams. You know, I always say, you know, people, we get a lot of messages of people wanting to set up their own teams or just want a bit of advice. And I always say, you know, we're here for our advice. Don't be afraid to ask us. We're not going to rip your head off. You know, we've all been there. We've all been you. So, but definitely try it out first. Don't just say, I'm going to be a ghost hunter or an investigator or whatever you want to be, and go out there, buy loads of kit, and then realize that you don't know what you're doing.
I think patience is a big one.
You
need to have patience.
You do. You need to have a bit of knackers as well, you know, because you're going to be in a dark place, and 9 times out of 10, you're going to be on your own as well. So, you know, if things do happen, you've got to really be able to handle that. And it's not for everybody. Go something. He's not for everybody. I don't think it is, you know. I wish it was, you know, because a lot of people that say to me, I want to do it, and you look at them and you take them out places and you think, you just haven't got it. You're not like the guy at the true crime, you know. It's just not for everybody. So try it out first. I'm happy to take people out of us if they want to come out on an investigation to see what it's like. Just tag along and see what you like about it and go from
and
there.
And persevere, because from my point of view, because I know, Jason, you weren't quite sure if I was up to it at first, were you? Because the way that I learn is I watch and I observe. I'm not sort of the sort of person who would step straight in and start going, yes, I can call out, I know what I'm doing, I'm super confident. I watch and learn and see what other people do before I feel confident enough to do things myself. And I think you thought I was like, she's not going to be able to do it, is she? But I was sort of working on, like, we had like this handbook that we hand out for members. Now I was working on that, and having worked on that, I just sort of like my confidence grew, didn't it? And I just took off from there. So even if you think you're not cut out for it at first, or you don't think that you can do calling out, because it is a bizarre thing, isn't it? Essentially talking to yourself in the dark.
Yeah.
You know, just keep at it. It's eventually it'll feel perfectly normal.
Oh, it's certainly a knack. You know, it's certainly something you do have to practice on.
Yeah. So just keep at it, yeah.
And be aware that a public investigation is very, very different from a team investigation. Yeah. I would say there's a huge difference between the two. One selling an experience, another is trying to get something.
Big event, 9 times out of 10 you're gonna spend half your night stood in a circle holding hands with each other. But when you're in investigation, you're looking at everything. You're looking at debunking what's there. You're not looking at what's the ghost. You're looking at the what is there. You know, is it natural occurrences and then ghosts So it's a lot more work. It's pressure as well. You've got to be able to handle the pressure, because if you're going to someone's house, you've got to make sure you know what you're doing. Because if you say there's not a ghost in there and they start floating, you've got some issues.
I'd like to add that nobody has come across that
but you never know. It's going to happen now to everybody because it's been locked down.
Paul, what would you advise?
Don't. No, on an all serious note, I would go with other teams and find out how they work. I'd look into the legalities of, if you're going to go into the event side of things as well, look at the legalities, DBSs and all that sort of stuff. And just basically enjoy yourself.
Yeah.
You know, enjoy what you're doing. Have, you know, like, there is a lot of negative people in the paranormal.
You have to have a strong backbone,
yeah,
don't you?
Whether or not it's intentional or not, I don't know. But, you know, take criticism, be open to it, don't take it personally. Yeah, just treat every comment as a water off a duck's back and just concentrate on what you want to do. Don't get involved in the politics. Just enjoy yourself. That's what I'd advise.
I would advise always learn.
Always
learn.
Willing to come away with something, yeah, even if you don't understand it.
Yeah. And don't think an orb is a spirit manifestation. It's the one I'd give. Having believed that for a while. Soon learn. On that note, we're actually coming to the end of the show. So, guys, any last thoughts?
We need to go back to Nettie's Ed.
I think we can put that in the diary for next year, perhaps.
I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to spending more time exploring that place because I feel, you know, parts of it felt rushed. Even though it wasn't rushed, it felt because we were so eager to say hello to people as well. And people getting lost. We didn't have really time to document everything in that place. So maybe going back with smaller teams, you know, and seeing what we get.
Can I just say as well, thank you to all you guys as well for coming, because without you guys, there wouldn't have been an event on that night. So thank you for coming down as well.
I think it was really well run. You know, I thought, like I said, we got there, and it was like we'd been working together for years, so it was great. Yeah.
It was a really lovely night.
Yeah, I liked it. It was nice seeing people. I hadn't seen some people for a while, so it was nice to see people.
Like me and Jason, we haven't seen each other for like, even though we're on the same team, we haven't seen each other for like 5 years.
Yeah.
I'm going to try and get it again for the same time, so obviously you're welcome to join us, and yeah, just be us. Guys.
We had a nice breakfast, didn't we, the next morning?
Oh, yes, lovely breakfast.
Oh, it was an amazing breakfast, wasn't it?
And we're on food.
And we're on food, really.
All right. It was quite nice because on the event, I was busy with other stuff and I was going around the other groups and stuff, so I didn't really get much chance to work with Jason and Amanda's team. But to sit down with them after at breakfast and discuss the night before and what they got and, you know, have a really good conversation with them, it was really good. I enjoyed that.
And it's an essential part of an investigation for me. If we're staying away, we've got to have a breakfast.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then they all watched me getting my submarine on the way home.
Yeah. I had a very comfortable journey back.
Yeah, great. Thanks,
boy. Yeah, you did. I didn't. I was shattered.
Anyway, on that note. Don't forget, guys, go over to our website, paranormalconcept.com. Catch up on all the blogs and all the past shows are on there as well. And you can even buy our book, which is The Paranormal Concept Extra. On that note, we've actually run out of time. So say goodnight, guys.
Good night.
Bye.
Good night, guys. Bye.